And with AI, that's really, really important for us.
It is. And it's one of those areas where I don't think an awful lot of us, you hear the buzzword, but you're not exactly sure how it's going to apply. But Tim, thanks very much indeed. Right, Jean-Briac Perrette now, the President and CEO of Discovery, is giving us our next keynote in the forum. Let's go there now.
Welcome in. Those people just arrive and come and take your seats. Just to say, if you haven't already, if you are joining us for your first session, you haven't already downloaded the IBC app, do it now because it's your way of interacting and being part of all the sessions. Look for IBC 2018 in your app store to post a question, take part in a session, rate them, just go to interact with sessions. And please feel free, if you are using social network, to use the hashtag IBC 2018. Now, as a global leader in real-life entertainment, Discovery has big ambitions to build on its strengths of being a differentiated kind of media company with content that serves loyal and passionate fan groups all over the world. Please welcome, it's weird talking about you whilst you're sat next to me, but just bear with me. Please welcome Jean-Briac Perrette, President and CEO of Discovery Networks International, who sets the strategy for Discovery's business outside the US. Discovery's unrivaled global footprint includes an average of 10 channels across 220 countries and territories. It's already been a very busy 2018, and he's here today to discuss many things, including their recent Scripps acquisition and a 12-year international multi-platform rights deal for the PGA Tour. JB, welcome. Can we give him a round of applause, please, ladies and gentlemen?
Thank you. Great to be here.
Now, before we get into it, though, we're going to take a look at just some of the Discovery family. Hopefully. Is that where I see you?
There's never been a time in the history of humanity where there has been more abilities to find like-minded people that have a passion for whatever it may be, food, travel, adventure, survival, on a number of different platforms. And our history has been for 30 plus years to do that in a way globally, but in the traditional linear television environment. And that continues to be a big part of our business and a very important part of our business. And despite all the changes, it's still a very healthy business, even though obviously people's viewership and the way they want to consume those passion areas is changing. And so our change as a company strategically is we want to now serve those passion groups not only in a linear environment, but in a non-linear environment. But we are uniquely positioned because we really feel like we're category leaders across a lot of these very passion-targeted passion groups. And different than what's going on with a Netflix and an Amazon and a Disney, Fox, Comcast, we're not trying to be the supermarket, you know, where you can have a little bit of everything. We are very focused on being the leaders in these passionate verticals around enthusiast communities. And so that's our path. We're trying to, we did that really well, and we continue to do that very well on the linear environment. And we are increasingly developing products to do that in the nonlinear environment. That's our golf deal you mentioned. That's Motor Trend, which is a digital auto enthusiast product. That's in your sport with our cycling and tennis verticals. We have a Discovery Kids app for kids. And so we're looking to do that and build out a portfolio of thematic vertical products to super serve those communities.
Shall we take a look
right
at that portfolio right now? Yes.
Whether we're finders or seekers.
linear and the digital world?
Look, I mean, we have a certain sort of bipolarity to it, which is ultimately we want to be really good at continuing to maximize and the linear viewership. And despite, as I said, despite a lot of the, we were talking before the session with a few of us, you know, it's been years that people have been sort of writing off linear television as dead. Certainly, as I say, we're eyes wide open that it is in people's viewing habits are changing, and it's people's use of television and linear television in particular continues to change. That said, there's still a huge amount of people who consume it that way, and so we want to continue to super serve that community, but at the same time, both in terms of taking the brands that exist there to new platforms where the younger generation, so we have, for example, in the U.S., launched all these what we call Go apps, which are essentially apps for each of our brands for people to access the content. And there we see, you know, we do over 500 million streams a month there, and, you know, almost half of it is 15 to 34 year olds. And so what we're having to do is just migrate. The linear world is certainly an older demo, and we're migrating both the existing brands as well as launching new brands. You know, this golf initiative is entirely something that we were never in. The golf community and the golf fans, it's not just a sport, but it's also a bit of a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And so for us, it's not just about producing an OTT app that serves live PGA Tour events and other events that we will have, but it's about tutorials. It's about equipment reviews. It's about, basically, if you are a golf fan, you cannot live without this service. And that's our ambition. And to do that, as I say, across several different verticals.
We'll get into kind of sport in more detail in a second, but one thing as well, you know, outside the US, which is kind of classified under international, it's a huge market and a big market that you have kind of penetrated really successfully. But is it important for you to kind of look at each region specifically and kind of tailor to that and kind of look where you can improve and invest and kind of develop in those specific areas as well?
For sure. So look, one of the things that has made Discovery successful internationally in the television world is that it started early, over 25 years ago, and it realized one thing that seems very basic, but that ultimately, unlike the U.S., it is not a one-size-fits-all. And so we tailor the product on television for each of the local markets. Now, not in every market, obviously, because it's a big world, and we're in 220 countries around there, but for the biggest markets, it's around creating local stories, local heroes, local characters that people can associate with, in the same way we've done that with Eurosport, which we bought at the time, and it was really a pan-European, you know, English language, and, you know, everybody knows there's no such thing as a pan-European sports fan. There's a German sports fan, there's a French sports fan, there's a British sports fan, and even within those, there are subsections. And so a lot of our lessons learned over the last few decades has been about the importance of local and local relevancy. And so when we think about the linear channels, we continue to actually try and make those more and more relevant. And when we think about these digital products, yes, it's about having a global footprint to it and a global platform underlying it. But ultimately, as we enter each of these markets, tailoring the product a bit to make sure that it meets the needs of the local territories.
And does that also then relate to where you acquire things, so you grow the Discovery family? You know, because 30 years ago, it started as one thing, and it's grown into this incredible collection of, you know, of broadcasters that are, you know, they work in certain territories better than others, but is that comes into the thought process about what you buy and where you go.
For sure. I mean, look, this is a journey. And we're not saying necessarily, we certainly don't have a crystal ball as to where it's going. What we do know is we want to continue to be the leaders in owning these passionate communities wherever they are. And so we are actively in this path of trying to focus on these targeted communities and develop products or buy products that marry. And we don't think, again, there's a lot written about, you know, television's going to die and internet's going to win, and we just don't see it that way. We see this as a multi-platform world that consumers want to be able to navigate across all those. Some will do more on one device or on one form, others will do it on another, but it's not a binary you know, I just want this or I just want that. They want to see it everywhere. And so for us, we want to meet that need. We're trying to sort of evolve the product suite to make sure we actually deliver that. And then on top of that, now that more and more of it's obviously IP-enabled and IP-delivered, is as we launch new products, like this Motor Trend product we acquired in the US and have now been building out and will be taking globally, we look at auto enthusiasts as a massive category. There's about a billion, if you exclude India and China and take the biggest markets, there's about a billion adults, of which almost 150 million are car enthusiasts. Our game is, you know, can we get even, you know, 10, 20% of those to sign up for a Motor Trend product that gives them everything about car reviews, car content, video storylines, and build up this suite over time, over the next 3, 5, 10 years, of products that will have 10, 20, 15, 30 million subs across the globe.
Sport has been something that's really grown, and your commitment to sport. We've got a great little kind of look at just how Discovery's embraced all manners of sport.
We'll come down to this third run.
The official home of the Olympics across Europe and the PGA Tour internationally. Why were these two specific things important?
Well, one thing, even maybe stepping back, because people sit there, and even though we've now been the owners of Eurosport for 5 years, you know, at the time people said, you guys are like the natural history people. What are you doing getting into sports? The reality is, as I say, when you think about our strategy, which is focused on, you know, enthusiast groups, obviously there is no more enthusiastic group than sports fans. And there's also, as people who have spent decades in what we call real-life entertainment, there is no bigger real-life entertainment than sport. And so from a content standpoint, the actual marriage to us was much more obvious. And obviously, as we think about movements to OTT and direct-to-consumer products, sport is arguably at the top of the heap of things that literally people will pay for before they'll pay for dinner. And so that migration for us was a natural extension. And where it is a little bit different for us is our focus, even within sports, is again, and this is where the PGA deal came in, around trying to find these sports that are, yes, sports that are highly viewed, but also sports that are lifestyles, and sports that are participatory. Mm-hmm. And so when you think of golf, when you think of cycling, when you think of tennis, which are certainly anchor now pieces of our portfolio, we want to try and develop products that even super serve those communities even deeper. That's what we're excited about. And over time, we want to try and continue to expand that.
How would you do that?
Well, look, we're at the beginning of that journey. The PGA Tour, as an example, is one where we started out with, number one, you need a kind of anchor partner. Jay Monahan and the team at the PGA were very like-minded in their ambition to develop this. They have, the leading property, I'd say, in the sport. A, you got to find a partner that aligns with the same vision. B, it has to be long-term. So we have a 12-year partnership with them. So it's a very long relationship. Then C, you got to have a content that works everywhere. So 50% of the players on the PGA Tour are international, non-US. So it's a global sport. It has obviously an affluent and willingness to pay is high within the community of fans of the sport. Then on top of that, it has volume. 42 weeks a year of programming, 4 days every week of matches. So there's a lot of volume. So that sort of serves as your anchor. Then beyond that, we think there's enormous amount, and this will take time. We'll launch in a few of the initial territories where we have the rights starting in January 19. That will be very focused on making sure we deliver a great live event experience. And over time, we will build out the other modules, if you will, of that product, and will be led by the consumer and the fans. And we're doing a lot of conversations and talking. The PGA Tour obviously knows their fans well, so they're giving us great input, and we're trying to figure out what are the other modules in that offering that would be killer. Some of it will be things like, we think, in Spain, while the broad coverage is about the events and the leaderboard and who's there, but if Sergio's playing, people want to say, they may just want to follow Sergio. And so we want to have Sergio cams available for fans in Spain who watch only Sergio play throughout a tournament. Customizations. Other elements would be using some of our production know-how from Eurosport, and you talked about the Olympics. Part of this is we obviously sublicense. There's probably no greater brand that marries up also with the Discovery brand than the Olympics. For that 2.5 weeks, kind of the world stops and focuses on this major event. And it's all about sports that are passionate sports and a very diverse set of sports. And we use that, as we did in Pyeongchang, to innovate, and our technology team does an incredible effort working with a lot of partners probably here on trying to figure out how do we tell not just the great stories, but how do we bring it to life in a different way. So in Pyeongchang, we had something called The Cube, which was one of sort of first of its kind augmented reality studio. And we brought people in, and they could get in and talk about, and we originally built it for the viewer. The hosts and the talent we had loved doing it. And then the big surprise was the actual athletes had so much fun coming into the Cube that we were at top of the list of people that where they wanted to come talk to. And so we had Sean White coming in, talk about his snowboard run, and he'd be able to pull himself out of the visual, move him in the center of the room and pivot the design. And so it's about telling, using the technology to bring to life the stories in a more relevant way and make people who are not necessarily even, mega fans understand the sport in a different way. And we want to bring that to the same thing to golf and to some of our other content verticals. You can imagine, being able to analyze Tiger's swing and pause it and rotate it and see where his knee angle is, etc. It's just another dimension of the storytelling that we think is really interesting for fans.
I wish you'd had Seve come when I first got into golf. That would have been amazing. We've got a wonderful look at just how you approach your golf coverage here.
Right at it. Right at it.
was going to say as well, I love how you've created technology to make the sun shine for every golfer.
Yeah, exactly.
Well,
exactly.
If only that were true. Could other sports fit into your portfolio?
Absolutely. I mean, look, we have already a set that we want to go deeper on. Mm. As I said, cycling and tennis is an example. We have a very big rights portfolio of that already, and we want to try and see how we can do more in that space. And over time, there'll be others. So I won't share them necessarily here, but there's a lot of things we're looking at.
Away from sport for a second, you recently partnered with ProSieben in Germany, kind of creating the first, I guess, true digital entertainment platform. Going back to what we were talking about focusing on a specific region and working on that as a whole kind of thing. Is that kind of where it's going for you in terms of, could that feature live streaming, pay TV content, sports? Is that kind of what you want to roll out?
Yeah, look, that's back to your question about international and the not one size fits all. One thing we pride ourselves in is we try and be fairly agile and not be too rigid in a fixed strategy that sort of says, no, we're not going to do something. And so over a decade ago, while we started our business as a pay TV business, we noticed that in many markets, particularly in Europe, pay TV was not penetrated as much as it has been, certainly, for example, in the US. Mm. And we had all this content and these brands that we wanted to take to consumers. And so rather than get stuck in saying we're a pay TV business, we said, look, let's go, and this is real credit to many of my predecessors and teammates who were still with us, and said we should just take these brands free to air. And so we moved into the free to air space in several markets across Europe, both organically as well as through acquisition. And we now have leading free to air businesses, broadcast businesses in the Nordics, in Poland. We're the number one broadcaster. We're the third largest broadcaster in Italy. We have free to air in the UK, in Spain, in Germany. And so in those models, we're much more of a broader broadcaster. And so in those markets, we are also focused, in addition to focus on this vertical strategy, we still believe that there's an opportunity to develop a bigger aggregated OTT offering, differentiated versus the Netflixes and the Amazons and others of the world by being the best of local. And ProSieben, our joint venture with ProSieben in Germany, is the beginning of that. We think there will be opportunities to do more of those in other markets across Europe, because we think for broadcasters, that is the future. It has to be. And while these big players are investing a lot of money and spending a lot of time and doing a lot of great things, that there's still a window for broadcasters across Europe and across the world, frankly, to partner, because it is going to need aggregation to come together and develop locally led aggregated content offerings. And so the ProSieben joint venture is the first step in that direction. We're excited and hopeful that we can get RTL and others in that market to come in with us and create, as I sort of helped do when I was at NBC many years ago, the Hulu model of the U.S. And obviously that's taken off and is now one of the leading streaming services in the U.S. And we think that model has legs in other markets around the world.
Talking about partnerships, Tim Davies earlier on in his speech mentioned that BBC Studios were working with Discovery on something, as a partnership. In terms of...
He talked about that?
He mentioned it.
Jeez.
I don't know if you want to elaborate on anything he said.
I didn't, no.
Okay.
Yes.
But in terms of those types of partnerships, is that another area where...
Totally. Look, we have a long history with the BBC and a great relationship with Tim and Tony and the team. And they've been great partners of ours on many different, and we're now obviously partners with them more specifically when we did the Scripps acquisition in the UK TV business. But they're a prolific producer. I mean, they're a world leader in a lot of categories. And we think there's a lot more. I think one of the things that we definitely see as a trend is this history of traditional competition amongst broadcasters. Look, it's still there and it's still healthy and we compete for audiences on a day-to-day basis. But at the end of the day, I think the playing field is now so much bigger and wider, and a lot of the lanes have been taken out, that we're going to have to figure out ways to partner more with people who we might have historically said are traditional competitors. And so absolutely, doing more with Tim and the team at the BBC would be one of those areas.
Can we talk a little about the making the acquisition of Acquired in Scripps and the decision behind that and kind of how you wanted
to... Look, it to us, it hit all the strategic filters. You know, it got us more scale in the traditional pay TV business, largely U.S., given that their dominance or their presence in the U.S. was much bigger than it was internationally. But so it got us more scale in our traditional pay TV business. It got us more category-leading content library. We now, as a combined group, have over 300,000 hours of content in our library. We produce 8,000 hours of original series a year. And all in this very targeted, focused area. They had brands that are that own categories in terms of food and HG in particular. And they hadn't really been, because they were later in the game to internet into the non-US business, they hadn't done as much internationally. And so we had the opportunity to use our infrastructure to be able to take those brands and take that content around the world. And because they had the brands, because they had the content in the categories, they were the perfect partner for us to go to extend our vertical strategy and our enthusiast strategy into food, into home, into travel. And so it was a perfect marriage for us. And we're sort of 6-7 months into it, and it's going fantastically.
You mentioned this enormous library of, you know, content that you have. Why is that important, and what do you see doing with it? How can you utilize it?
I think at the end of the day, all these platforms that are evolving and all these, you know, rectangular devices that are coming out every day in different sizes and X's and S's and all this other stuff, as we saw the other day out in California, we are all those things need one thing: content, and they need stories. And so while this revolution in distribution technology, in devices and access is fantastic from a consumer standpoint, but at the core of it, it still needs great stories. And so we're a believer, and we're, you know, a very, as our CEO says, you know, we're long IP, we're long content creation. And we believe all these platforms need content, whether it be the mobile guys, the broadband guys, the device guys, they need content. And so we want to be a preferred partner and bring with it content that is killer for these targeted communities.
Discovery also owns half of All3 Media, the maker of global hits like Midsommar Murders. How important is it owning content production?
Look, All3 has been a great partner of ours. They actually produce a lot of content for us, so it's been they're a very important partner for ours. And similar to what we were just talking about, owning the IP and the content and the production know-how is, we think, key to the strategy. And so it's been a great partnership that we'll continue to do more with them over time.
Some great questions coming in, so please keep them coming in as well. I'm going to go to a couple right now. You can put your name in as well. You don't need to be anonymous.
Depends on the question.
Well, yeah, they're not that offensive. Anonymous says, how can you ensure your competitive position in sports while FANG are entering this space, notably Facebook and Amazon? I hate that term.
Yeah. Look, in terms of ensuring it, there's no 100% answer to that question. I think two things. Number one is there's a lot of talk about them entering the space, and obviously they are doing things and experimenting, and Amazon's experimented in the UK in particular, and Facebook has done some deals in Asia. But these guys are very smart companies, and you know, the sports space is not for the faint of heart, and they're not entering I don't think with the pure ambition of, I guess there's one strategically a question of whether they're really long-term players or whether they're using it as a marketing. You know, if you're Facebook and you got 2 billion users and you got to figure out how to grow, there's only two markets or one part of the world that's going to get you the kind of growth to get you to 4 billion, and that's Asia. And so I think it's not surprising that you've seen them focus their sports investment in Asia, because they're trying to use that as a marketing tool to get users in. So A, I think there's a question more for federations and players is that, are those guys interested in sport as a long-term strategy, or is it a marketing tool to try and get users in for some period of time and then eventually it'll go away? Not dissimilar to what some of the telcos have done in playing in sport and then potentially eventually getting out. The second thing is, look, it's all of this is a speed question and a competence question. So, you know, we're trying to develop capabilities in terms of the storytelling, in terms of the services around there, in terms of the customer acquisition pieces and all the cable capabilities around managing these verticals that gives us something that we can provide uniquely. Now, obviously, these are huge companies that have enormous resources, but you know, the history of business is that it's littered with a lot of big companies that when they try and go after sort of more targeted things have failed miserably because size doesn't always win out. And so we're going to stay focused on, you know, pushing ahead. And we're also doing it in ways that are giving us long-term viability to it. So our PGA is an example. We didn't do a two-year or three-year deal only so that in 3 years we find out that, no, now someone else is going off and bite the rights. We bought it until, you know, 2030. And that partnership, and we hopefully will be even longer than that. So I think a lot of it is also trying to bring into these partnerships a long-term arrangement.
Another anonymous one says, what do you think on VR? Will it become a major consumption platform?
Yeah, look, we've tried to lead in the VR space. We did a lot in our, both for Discovery Channel, as well as we've done some great stuff with our sports brands around VR. So we think it's very interesting. And I think it's going to take time. You know, we were a very early adopter, and we invested heavily with Sony and IMAX in 3D at the time, because part of our DNA as a company, not surprising given the brand, our leading brand in Discovery, is about trying to be innovative, on particularly on the technology side. And it turned out the 3D went nowhere, at least from a media perspective. But that's okay, we're gonna keep swinging at it. And so VR, I think, feels right now like it's more on the 3D track. AR, we think, is much more interesting, partly because it's just the device and the headset issue. So I think we're focused on continuing to play in both, but ultimately, I think for now, see more progress on the AR side, not just from a consumer standpoint, but also from a production standpoint. And so, as I mentioned earlier, using AR to try and augment our own broadcasts, whether it be sports or other.
And kind of funding all this stuff, this is a really interesting area of what Tim talked about earlier, was the change in business model and how do we fund TV going forward, whether that's what we see on our screens or what's going on behind the scenes in terms of investment in technology and that kind of thing. And talking about, you know, where that money was coming from, especially against, you know, deep pocketed tech platforms and stuff. Where do you stand on that discussion?
Well, our business model is today, you know, fairly simple. It's funded by distribution, which is subscriber fees and advertising. Again, you know, there is a desire generally to always sort of make this a binary game that, you know, either television is going to die and, you know, tech companies are going to own everything, or I'm not sure it's that binary, and I'm not sure it's going to end up that way. I think the tech companies do great things, and they have obviously enormous resources. But, you know, I just use as an example, you know, YouTube has been trying to go after the TV space for a decade. And they have a great business, and they do wonderful things, but it's different than television. And so whether you talk about the issues around, you know, brand association or, you know, safety, brand safety, there's things that they still, as great as they are as a company and as leading as they are in technology, they still can't quite figure out. And so we are, we still believe that in these verticals, in particular, given our strategy, you know, if you're an auto manufacturer or anywhere in the auto supply space, and we can deliver to you, not theoretically or not algorithmically, a bunch of auto enthusiasts, but because we know these people come to our site every day at scale, pay us money, and are watching stuff related to autos, that's highly valuable. You know, if you talk to any marketer, they'll tell you, you know, increasingly what they want is really contextually relevant and closer to purchase. Mm-hmm. So if we can, through these products, get you highly contextually relevant, branded and brand safe, and data on the users, to us, you know, the future of the advertising business, as much as it will change, and certainly TV will continue to evolve, but in these new product lines, that that prospect is incredibly exciting for us.
Thank you for putting your names on your questions now. This is great. John says, global companies aren't known for their entrepreneurial spirit, nor speed and agility. How will you keep up with tech companies that are?
It's a great question. I might challenge the hypothesis a little bit in the sense that, you know, I know a lot of people who work at some of these big tech companies, and they're not necessarily as quick, particularly some of the ones that have gotten really big, as they used to be. But nonetheless, the question is very fair, and it's a fear. You know, I say the number one thing to my team, the number one thing that concerns me is time. You know, time is not our friend in, A, the consumer sense, which is that, you know, consumers now have more ways to distract themselves than ever before. You know, we operated in a great business where for decades television was the primary and only way to get any form of entertainment, and that was great because we had a captive audience. Mm. Now, you know, whether it's your mobile, whether it's your computer, whether it's your game console, whether it's whatever, there's so many ways of distraction. So time is not our friend from a consumer standpoint, and time's not our friend from a product standpoint. We got to be moving faster. We got to be moving more aggressively. The thing that I take comfort in is, again, the one thing Discovery has stood for and we've done, I think, very well, and our CEO leads the pack on this, is just play offense. And every year this company has looked different. We weren't in the sports business, we're in the sports business. We weren't in the Olympics. No pan-European provider had ever owned the Olympics across Europe. We've done that. Nobody had done a, you know, 12-year deal with a major sports franchise. We're moving. We're not we're humble enough to know that we may not have all the right answers, and we still don't. But at the end of the day, we're moving forward aggressively with this very clear strategy, and you know, we believe that, you know, it's ours to lose.
It kind of leads on really nicely to Anil Wanvari's question, and something I wanted to ask as well. How do you see Discovery structure 10 years down the line? But also, when you talk about these areas that you're going into, sport and whether it be Eurosport or golf and stuff, what other areas can you see yourself going into to give those kind of enthusiasts that immersive experience?
Yeah, the way I think about what the company looks like in 10 years is we are today largely a company that's about sight, sound, and motion storytelling, long-form storytelling. That's our bread and butter. That's what we do. And that will continue to be the case. But instead of being, you know, 80 to 90% that, over time, I think we will be that plus. And that plus means we will also be, we have to become a great product company in the digital and the technology sense of the word. And we will have other service that we will develop on top of that, whether those sometimes may be gaming, whether they sometimes may be other service layers. And so the company will have to evolve and look like not just a great content company, but a great content and product company. Mm. And that's not easy, and it's not, you know, certainly plenty of people will say, oh, you know, there's not a lot of good examples of companies that have done that, and that's, I think, fair enough. But that doesn't deter us.
The gaming world is a world that hasn't really been broached by broadcasters kind of well yet, I don't think. Do you agree? Is that a world that could be developed?
Yeah. I mean, there's a little bit of a, you know, as the linear TV platform ages, mm-hmm. Obviously a lot of the gaming stuff is inherently focused on a younger demographic. And so there's a certain element of, I'm not sure those two platforms are necessarily fully compatible, but I certainly think, and this is something we've spent a lot of time looking at, and we haven't found anything yet that made sense, but we continue to look at it. The esports space is massive, you know, in terms of time spent as well as where people are focused, and so that's an area that's incredibly interesting, there may be opportunities there that make sense, but it is, it's an area that we'll continue to look at.
Juan Luna says, do you see a full transition of the HD linear channels to 4K in the next 3 years?
In the next three?
Yeah.
No.
Four?
I don't know. Yeah, but I mean, I think, look, we launched our first 4K, full 4K channel with Eurosport in Eastern Europe. We're going to continue to evolve with sports inherently probably leading the pack on the 4K. As we prepare for Tokyo in 2020, we'll be doing a lot more in 4K. And so it's an evolution that we continue to push forward on. Mm-hmm. The issue is partly also just, you know, a lot of our distribution partners, for bandwidth reasons, aren't necessarily looking for a whole suite. And we're also focused on, you know, while you continue to move forward on more bandwidth-hungry next-gen technologies, we also have to figure out how do we eventually cut off the older gen, because that's also taking. So all the SD feeds that we still distribute, you know, over time you'd like to figure out a way to eliminate the SD feeds and just get to an HD distribution at a minimum, even if there's some down conversion off the HD feeds. But so there's an evolution that has to happen, but it's not just about progressing from a bandwidth perspective. It's not just about progressing to the next. It's also about making sure the older technologies are being sunsetted.
Yeah, nice way of putting it. Mikhail Barker, who used to be my boss at MTV. Hello, Mikhail. Of all sports, esports has some of the most engaged and passionate audiences. What are your thoughts on that?
I agree. I agree. I mean, it's a really interesting business, and the issue is, you know, trying to figure out how, you know, a company like ours plays in that space, because you have on the one hand the publishers who do the games, and then on the other end extreme you got the distribution outlets, so whether that be at YouTube or Twitch or and then you have sort of organizers in the middle. You know, I think we are focused. We also want to be careful in this strategy not to take on too many new things at once. I think a lot of this, particularly as you're trying to make this massive pivot, you want to make sure you master one thing at a time. So we don't know what the entry point is there exactly yet, but it is. He's absolutely right. It's massively engaged, enormous numbers, and I think is one that will continue to grow. We're just trying to figure out what the right entry point is.
Two last questions. Savannah says, how do you see development and use of AI for the huge amount of content Discovery has today?
Say that one more time.
How do you see development and use of AI for the huge amount of content Discovery has today?
Yeah, look, I think that is also a great question that we are barely getting started at. And I think as we look at some of these, we just did a test, we just did a trial with Baidu in China on trying to leverage some of their AI tools to develop content for their home device. Such that you could call up if you said, North America or deer or, reindeer or whatever, and we have content related to it that you could ultimately find it, and then over time it would learn more about you. And so we're testing stuff. Wow. And experimenting. The reality is we're at the very early stages of figuring out exactly how best to utilize it.
Kate asks a question, who's been hosting a lot of the sessions up here. She says, Endemol Shine is for sale. Why wouldn't you buy it? Is it worth $2
billion? I have no
There's
comment.
There's three questions in there, but yeah.
It's a great company. It's a great company, and we have a lot of respect for them. I wouldn't comment on either one of those. what it's worth, I don't know, but we don't really comment on what we're looking at or not looking at.
Well, let's finish with this one from Matt from Riot Games, who says, you mentioned investigating esports. What do you think esport production can learn from traditional sport production and distribution?
Great question. I think over time, trying to make these things bigger and bigger events. You know, I think what sports does well is taking an event and ultimately, you know, sort of supersizing it, making it so much bigger than the game. And maybe as part of that, the one thing that makes sport particularly relevant is people feel associated to the heroes, and local heroes in particular. And so I think probably most importantly, which has nothing to do with the technology of how it's produced, and because I don't, you know, the person who asked the question probably has better ideas than I do. But I do think from a storytelling perspective, the one thing that needs to evolve is developing the storylines around the heroes, because that ultimately, if you think about continuing to grow the audience and the fan base for any sport, it's about the heroes and about the stories around those heroes. And so developing the characters around esports, I think probably can learn something from the sort of traditional sports arena.
Great. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
JB, thank you very much indeed.
Thanks.
It's time for lunch, everyone. Don't forget to check out the lounge talk and networking in the Forum Lounge in 15 minutes, where Mike Armstrong from BBC Research and Development will be discussing his work from epic poetry to AI. Back here at 1:30 after lunch, where Jett Nygaard-Andersen of Modern Times Group in Sweden will be taking to the Global Game Changer stage to reveal how an established media company can reinvent itself, capture growth opportunities, and generate sustainable value. JB, thank you very much. Thank you for your questions as well, everyone. Thank you.